things where you think you know right off the bat what it is, but sometimes you actually have to do a little work and decide what the right thing is to do before that. You have to gather facts and get the information in order to make the decision. It's more like an ethical decision. If you evaluate the decision, you need to make sure you get a clear understanding of the outcomes. There's going to be a pro and a con to every decision you make. It's going to be difficult, but if you get the information that you have before, or if you don't get the information in the first place, you'll never be able to make the right decision. You have to have a clear understanding of best practices and procedures, and that will help you choose the right one. You take the information you gather, and then you kind of go through the filter of our best practices and, you know, what we have as company standards, and then you make your choice. You have to keep your emotions in check. After the first presentation with Jan, see how emotions can kind of make you lean more one way than the other. So sometimes you have to, if you're a naturally extroverted person, you're going to be able to just deliver information pretty easily. And if you're introverted, it's going to be a little bit of a challenge to relay some information. So do a post-game analysis. Discuss the situation with a manager, supervisor, or someone. And their perspective might be different, and maybe give you a, you know, feedback as to maybe change the way you handle that situation a little bit. Or the way you did it might be right, and that might help them. So lean on others. You know, jump on Skype if you see somebody online. I've done this a couple of times, and just ask questions, especially the people who know more about Dave or other things. See that this isn't right. How do I change it? Where do I go? Dan's a good resource that I use, and it's pretty nice. I've even asked Beth a couple of questions, you know, visual audit questions, and she's always good. Being accessible. This is a very important thing about customer service. Accessibility, you know, does inspire confidence. You have to be dependent on to answer questions and solve problems quickly. We hardly ever get questions saying, oh, that was a great audit, you know, a call, and it's wonderful. Usually somebody wants something, there's a problem, or it needs to be resolved fairly quickly. So you have to be able to be accessible. Many times when they call, they are obviously going to be feeling stress, and you have to alleviate it as quickly as possible. Take, for example, you know, if you have to call, say you look in your bank account, something was taken out three times, and obviously there's a problem, and you call somebody on the other line, you don't want to have to wait. You don't want to have to sit on hold. You don't want to have them call you back. You want to handle quickly, especially a great example is my wife and I traveled to Dallas, Texas, and went to buy her something at the store. Credit card didn't go through. What the world? Call up Chase. They were like, oh, we put it as potential fraud. We didn't know you were traveling. You need to do, you know, let us know that you were traveling. Simple issue that were really quick. Bank of America, not so much. It took forever. So I was very impressed with the Chase service. Now, in the field, sometimes you have the second picture for your cell service. You're not going to be accessible. There will be no email. There will be no Dave. Nothing. What you might need to do is, you know, when you do get back to civilization, check your voicemail, check your emails. I was talking with Andy earlier, in the hurricane, something happened with the cell towers. My phone automatically switched to Central Time when I got to this area. My wife's phone did not, and I think it was with the carrier settings. So sometimes check things like that. But it is very important, though, to make sure you're accessible, because, like I say, when they call, usually there's a problem, and it needs to be handled as quickly as possible. Sometimes you're not going to be able to solve the problem. You're going to need to, you know, call someone else. You're going to need to, you know, follow up with another department. Give somebody a reasonable expectation of when you're going to get back to them. You never want to tell them, let me call you back in 15 minutes, and then 30 minutes later you're calling, because they've been right waiting around the whole 30 minutes. Some things I learned about this was, who you're talking to also depends on how they want you to contact them. Voicemails, texts, emails, there are different ways. Some people prefer just an email. They just don't have the time to talk on the phone, they're busy doing other things. Try to figure out whoever you're talking to. Some insurers, you know, especially millennials now, really want the non-voice communication. They want the text and the voicemail or the emails as opposed to a call. So just kind of, you know, figure that out. Sometimes you have to actually talk to them, and you kind of have to force some people to be comfortable with that. The main thing is you want to be honest. Sometimes the information you have to give is bad, and you have to just not sugarcoat it. Tell them exactly how it is, give them the reasons why, and they may not like your decision, but they will respect the fact that you were honest about things. Be interactive. Communication is two ways. You know, if they call you and you're not able to respond right away and you call them back, maybe draw more information out. They might not have given you enough information in the voicemail or the email or anything else. Especially, just having to talk about this with someone else, chain emails with multiple people on the email chain. You have to read them all. Sometimes you might skip one, sometimes somebody might not send you prior information. So just double check that, because you don't want to ask a question that's already been answered and then have to go back through and start the whole conversation over again. It just wastes everyone's time. And there's one step that kind of surprised me. 75% of customers believe it takes too long to reach a live agent. I don't know why that isn't 100%. Now, demonstrating workers' comp expertise. We are all experts in this room, in our own minds. Competence comes before confidence. And it says here, expertise is vital to gain and maintain credibility. If you're confident with how you distribute your information, people are going to find you believable, understand that you're an expert, and generally side with your decision. If you say, this person is going to have to go into 5606, right? They're not going to buy it. But if you tell them, this person needs to go into 5606 because of this, this, and this, then they'll understand your decision for doing it, and they'll give you that credibility to say, you're the expert, you know where they need to go. I don't want to pay more, but I'm going to have to. Knowledge is power. It gives you the ability to share it with others and educate. And it also allows you to make the better decisions and do the right thing. Sometimes you're going to have to, you know, educate the insurer on the class codes, the laws, and sometimes even on their own accounting software. They might not even know how to run some of that. Your tacit knowledge is derived from your personal know-how and what you do every day. It's just an intuition. It's something you know because of experience and doing it all the time. That is difficult to write down and pass on to people. So if you, for instance, Dan and I had an audit where the business was sold to a big corporation, and they have no experience in the industry that they're on. They have had to extend the owners on as consultants for more than 6 months because they're not able to pick up that information, because it's just the owners have always done it. So they never really trained a successor. Now the explicit knowledge, which is articulated knowledge that can be easily documented and transferred, had they done that, it would have been an easy switch. They could have had somebody already trained, given them that knowledge, and they could have been the experts. We all have that tacit knowledge. We need to make sure we also have it in the explicit knowledge. Ways to do that would be through journals, books, articles, training courses. We have a lot of stuff on My Learning, which is really good. Your CPCU classes, APA classes, webinars, giving presentations like this. This is not my forte, but by doing this, it helps me get a little bit better at public speaking, and you learn it as well. Sometimes I'll ask Dan, the thing that I perform the least well at, let me do a presentation on that, because doing the research, I get a little bit better. Spending time with other departments. Our knowledge is workers' comp, but there's claims, there's different departments that we might not be as knowledgeable about. Spending time in those other departments can round out our knowledge and give us the background as to why certain decisions are made. The brain is a muscle, does need to be exercised. So also you can join, you know, memberships, you know, auditor associations, HOAs, anything, you know, church groups, just something where you can, you know, practice using your mind in certain things. Now, ensuring exceptional customer service. My background was from a hotel, so I had an extreme amount of customer service training. It does begin with trust, and we are going to deliver what we say we're going to do. You know, you tell the insurer that we're going to take care of you, we're going to do it for a really good price, we're going to give you all these valuable things. You have to deliver on it in order to make sure that they feel they made the right decision. Now, we have a couple of different customer bases. I thought about this after I finished it, and I said we have two customer bases. We actually have three. We have agents and then the businesses that they serve, but we also have internal customers, you know, with underwriting and QC in-house. We consider them co-workers, I guess. That's up here. We need to take care of our injured workers. We need to make sure we prevent those accidents through loss control. They're going to happen, though, so we need to make sure we take care of them. And we need to also work with the other departments because their job is sometimes equally as tasking as ours. What we do might make somebody else's job a lot harder. So if we can help their job a little bit easier, they can help us with our job a little bit easier. Since I've called and I've sat in with claims a couple of times, it's so much easier to just, you know, make a call. Hey, I have this question. I'll get the answer pretty quick. Sometimes I do that through Skype if she's on. April Lassiter, I believe, is the person I usually talk to the most. And since we talked face to face and we've actually built a relationship, it's a little bit easier. And she'll sometimes tell me, hey, I'm busy, I can't do it right now. But at least, you know, the communication is there. Now, our agents are the primary customers because if they don't have faith in our customer service and we're doing a good job, they're going to write it somewhere else, and then nothing is possible. Now, the exception of customer service may be completely different depending on the person. We've had some agency visits where we go in and the agent actually tells us, I would really prefer if you weren't here and out there doing the job, and I can reach you through email, text, and phone. And our AE was perfect about it. He was like, I'm glad you told me that, because that lets me know that we just need to come in here, introduce ourselves, and now we can just, you know, communicate through whichever way we prefer. Some agents want constant emails and constant calls, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. They're usually the ones that take care of their clients the best, even though they are going to need a little bit of extra service. Some of our in-house people, like I say, would prefer the emails, prefer the, you know, text, voicemails, because they're busy doing things during business hours, and sometimes we're out there late, and, you know, maybe it's something that we just thought about at the end of the day, just send it an email. Some of the things on this, I like some of these quotes. Just having satisfied customers isn't good enough anymore. If you really want a booming business, you have to create raving fans. And how many people would be willing to pay more for our services, because we're usually not the cheapest, because we have better value. So it's just, you know, kind of like Bill Gates, your unhappy customers are the greatest source of learning. No matter how well you try, you will never be 100% successful in making a customer happy. When you make them not happy, it's an opportunity. That's when you really get to shine. If you can take someone who is unhappy and turn the complete situation around, they will become a very loyal customer. Now, value added promotes customer retention. They'll come back. Value unique nurtures customer advocacy. They'll also tell their friends to come in and join us. And that's one of the biggest things. If you make somebody mad, they're going to tell 100 people. If you make somebody happy, they might tell 2 or 3. So try to make sure you have driven by long-term stability. accomplishing short-term goals allow us to have long-term stability. Catching short-term goals have to head in the right direction. So if we're all pulling on the rope in the same direction, we can move in the right direction. If claims is handling something one way, or underwriting is handling something one way, and we're handling it some way differently, the customer's going to be confused. They're not going to be happy. We're not going to reach our goals, and nobody will be happy. And now, those short-term goals, if we have a good best practices and good procedure, we're going to be able to, you know, replicate those. That'll help us when we grow into different states. That'll help us grow market share. And we'll have better confidence to know that we're going to be successful. Now, I think the best part about this is through the worst times, when the markets were really bad, if we do our job and we're doing it the right way, we're going to be able to maintain where we're at, even though it was 2008, the Great Recession. I think we did pretty well. It struggled. It was really hard. But many other companies failed. So you have to have long-term stability, but you have to do that with a short-term goal and accomplishing those consistently. Building strong relationships. This is the first step in making somebody a loyal customer. If you don't have a relationship, it's very difficult to get your personality across. This is one thing that it's the Jesus, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Treat them like they were a family member, is how I was taught at the hotel. You might see that guy come in and he's had 8 hours in the car with three kids and they're just yelling and screaming. He just wants his key and he wants to get to the room. You give him the whole 15-minute spiel about breakfast isn't this time, we have a pool, we have a workout. He just wants the key and wants to get to the room. Other people taking pictures, looking around, you can take those nonverbal cues and say, hey, that's a person I'm going to spend a little bit extra time. Alabama. Look around at like sports memorabilia. You look around at family photos. You look around at things on the wall. You'll be able to find something that you can relate to with that person. It's something that's pretty funny. It makes your job a little easier. If you build this relationship, they're going to be so much easier to get information from. They're going to trust you. You're going to ask for that journal letter. They're not going to say, oh, why do you need that? I'm not going to do that. That's private company information. But if you sat there and talked to them for about 20 minutes about his pet, how's your wife doing? Is she fine? I know she had surgery a while back. It's going to really help out. On this commitment, I think that commitment intimacy, and what I mean by that is, in order to build that relationship, you have to give some of that personal information as much as you're comfortable with. You'll share pictures of your pets, your children, whatever. If you're at a game, a sporting event, and they're a fan of the same college, hey, I was at the game. How about you? You can build those relationships, and they will definitely make it worthwhile. The most important thing is that they're not the insured. It was beaten into me with a laptop that you don't start out the description box as the insured is. They have a name. They're a person. They have children, pets. They're nervous. They sometimes have, they're struggling. Treat them as a person, not as a business. You treat them as a person, they're going to feel that relationship and that connection. And I'm going to go to empathy here. It's not enough to respect a person's point of view, kind of try to feel it. If you can understand why they're upset, maybe they're an industry that just went through a hurricane and they're struggling. They had some employees who were displaced, buildings that were knocked down. Try to understand what that might mean to them. Maybe they were underinsured. Maybe they're going to have to cut some jobs. Be mindful of that. Try to give them a little bit more time. Work with them a little bit more. Get in touch with your manager, your supervisor, and say, hey, these people are struggling. We need to take a little bit more, might take a little bit more time. Maybe I'll let them send me some information and go out a little bit later. But when you feel that, they will understand that and they will really respect it. Now, focused on our customers, more than 6 out of 10 companies or consumers say that their go-to channel for simple inquiries is digital stuff. We're doing a lot of stuff that way because we actually look at what our customers want. More of them are wanting the digital dashboards. They're wanting the non-verbal communication. They're wanting the webcam. They're wanting to be able to do things a little bit quicker and a little bit faster. So since they are the primary reason we are here, we look at what do they want? Accurate audits. They don't want to have to go through disputes. They want that customer service and that knowledge. They're not workers' comp experts. We are. So we are actually helping them understand workers' comp, what it is, why they need it. Even though sometimes they're not very grateful for it. Now, we do industry surveys, we do internal surveys to find out what the customers want. And that's why they drive a lot of these things. I personally hate the voicemail digital stuff. I like the in-person conversation. Even though I'm an introvert, I don't know how it works, but that's the way I am. But the e-commerce tools make it easier to do business because they're busy doing other things. The economy's coming back. It's getting a lot faster. Companies now need to be more agile. They're run now by an increasing number of millennials who just want to get it done faster with email, with fax, you know, over the email. I don't know if they even send a letter anymore hardly. Now, focused on the customers, the thing about that, you have to understand what they want. Some people do want just low cost, low bottom dollar, in and out, no pros. They want an exit interview of a minute. Sometimes, in doing the right thing, it's the hard thing to do. You have to say, no, I need to let you know this information, because this is why your premium is going to double. You know, I can't just give you that 1 minute. Now, a couple of takeaways from this. They're not random thoughts and research. Yeah, they're who we are. We don't need to go through a big process of, you know, reinventing anything, or we just need to look at maybe a couple of these items that aren't our strengths. Work on those. The ones that you are strong on, don't let those lapse. Because if you work on just a couple, like I say, the mind's a tool, it does, you know, muscle, you might lose a little bit of that. So to keep working on all of them, just focus on a few actions. How well we perform these beliefs can be improved with that awareness. Like I say, this is not my forte, this is not what I like to do, but doing it, you get better at it, just practice it. Maybe talk to somebody who you think is really good at a certain, you know, job. Accessibility is one of my difficult points. And the difficult point about that is I want to answer the phone every time it rings. It's not a good idea. When you're driving in the car and you can't take a note, it is answerable. But you'll have to make a call back to someone. You may have to, you know, pull over to the side of the road, take a note. You might misplace it. You might not go in that day pointer to change the car. Now, mastering these beliefs, we're an industry leader. And people will turn to us. Agents will say, hey, I want Summit because I know what they're going to do and I can count on it. Other insurance companies, I don't know about you guys, if you've gotten feedback, sometimes the bar is really low. It's easy for us to surpass. But there are other companies that are just coming on and they're doing a really good job. I hate going into a certain insurance or to a cancellation audit and understanding that they're going to a different certain carrier, because we have a coworker that used to work there, so I don't like that too much. If we do our job and we make our agents really happy, we make our insureds really happy, we make it really hard for them to do business with anyone else. And I have had people who do audit for other companies, and they were a small company and they don't have enough premium for us. Well, I'm sorry, there's nothing I can really do, but check and see if there's a different, you know, agent that might have a Great American policy that you can get. And another thing about this, which is my biggest takeaway, is that these beliefs aren't just about work. They also can apply your private life. Doing the right thing is always, you know, easy. Accessibility. You know, if you work at these things, it will really help in all things of your life. There are a couple examples I want to go through of like doing the right thing. I had a sheet metal manufacturing company, and this gentleman is a small company, wasn't very adept at payroll records. Had good software, just didn't know how to use it because he's an elderly guy, disabled veteran, and didn't keep a proper payroll split for installation. So put it on iTrade code, and he was, of course, not happy. Went out there at the request of the agent, talked to him, checked out his records. He kept the hours, didn't keep any of who the people were that were on the job. So I was like, I don't know who to assign the payroll to. In that situation, it's, you don't just say, no, I can't do it. Sorry, sorry for your loss. You're gonna have to pay up the next. Got in touch with underwriter, got in touch with the agent. Hey, is there an accommodation we can do? I was like, the insured said, hey, I'll pay the highest rate for just those hours. I'd take my highest paid employee and multiply him by the number of hours for installation. And I was like, well, sounds good to me, but I can't do that. Let me see what I can do. And through underwriting, we were able to come to an accommodation. The right thing is look for a solution. Don't just say no, Just try to find as much as you can. Accessibility, I talked a little bit about this. I like to answer those calls immediately, but it's very tough. And the guy went on for about 15 minutes, hit me with like five rapid fire questions, and I just couldn't tell him. I'm like, I'm driving, I can't. Looking at this up, I don't have my computer. I'll reschedule it a later date. On the expertise, a couple of months ago, I had a situation where the lady didn't know how to prep her payroll. So she just had to get rid of her bookkeeper, and she didn't know how to do the payroll side. So she just logged me into her computer. So here, sit down, do the audit. And I was like, she's great. Give me that 5 minutes. But the correct thing was that I sat down and I said, hey, come over here and look, and I'll show you how to print these out. You might need to do this for general liability audit or something else, before you hire a new bookkeeper. So I just took a little extra time and educated her on how to use that payroll system. And she was really happy about it. She was mad because it was a fee audit mix up, and they couldn't do the audit because the records were incomplete. So just taking a few extra minutes and doing that, she was really happy about that. Exceptional customer service. I'm going to include this one with building strong relationships. I had an audit a couple weeks ago, and not even an audit. It's an insured that I've audited for 5 years, 6 years. And it's a family-owned trucking company. Well, I heard through the agent that the owner of the company had died. So I was like, it's terrible. But I've been there quite a few times. Their son had just come on to take over the business. Then looking in the system, I found out the owner of the company died, going to pick up his nephew, who had broken down one of the trucks. And then realized that the nephew had died also because they were on their way back and they hit an icy spot in the road and went into the water. Mm-hmm. So I took an extra 15, 20 minutes and drove and went and saw the people. Just hugged the lady. She was upset. She was crying and everything. Little things like that will really make it where they will go out of their way to stay with us. I mean, they'll pay almost any extra premium, reasonable amount to stay with us because I really care. I hated the fact that had happened. And I told her, I was like, I remember all the time when I would come to do the audit, just now in his office. And it really meant a lot to them. And focus on the customers. It's just, I did a couple audits with, I think Dean was doing the Florence area. I did the Florence area first, and then I got it back not even a year ago. And it had been 3 or 4 years since I'd seen this lady. But when I walked in, she remembered that I had dogs and she had dogs. And I saw a picture and I was like, oh, my dog, I know he was not doing too well. Talked about it, she had to put him down. And I talked about it. I wanted to do the same thing many, many years ago. If you make a memorable impression like that on the customer, they're going to work in customers, and they're going to go out of their way. Agents will still call you even though you have no policy for them because they trust you how much. A Does anybody have any examples similar? I mean, I just, you know, doing the right thing, being accessible. Like I say, I mean, I struggle with some of those things. So, I mean, I could use somebody who is a really good, you know, leader of these type of traits. So if you have any, offer them up. You know, if the auditor says, hey, I'm having trouble with this, you know, help them out. You know, this is how I would handle it. I don't know about you. And I think we do that from time to time in some of these meetings. Some of the best information is when we're outside these walls. You know, we're just talking about situations that happen. So just try to do that here from time to time. Jill and I do that. You know, it's our territory, we sometimes have long drives and she'll call us. You got one over here? And I'm like, yeah, I do. I have one canceled. I'm not going to be over here for a while. Can you take it? I'll say yes. I'm going to stay on the phone for a while. You know, I just had this happen. I just saw this lady. We had an audit one time at the same location. The lady had two businesses, and somehow one was assigned to her and one was me. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to be here at 10:30. And she, I got Jill coming at 1 o'clock. I'm like, I know Jill.
We ended up meeting for lunch that day.
Yeah. And it was great. So I was looking at, you know, just to make the calls, especially people in your territory, and especially if they're not, you know, if they're in a different area, because you might be auditing out of state. You know, it's like, give Chris a call every now and then. Like his brain, you know, Jill's on, you know, Tennessee accounts, you know, certain things that I don't deal with every time, all the time. So, they're good resources. Yeah, if you have any feedback, any questions, call. So I'm on Skype. I don't necessarily have everybody here added online, but usually sometimes I'll be on there and be able to answer a question or two. If I'm on there, I will have a question or two, I can promise you that. But yeah, that's all I got. I don't know, anybody, any feedback?
Thank you.